This is Clean Radio, and it starts now.
I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh, Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood.
Eric Burden and the Animals. Eric Burden gave me my very first drug when I was 16 or 17 years old. Decided to throw that in.
What drug was it?
It was one of those yellow jackets.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, uh-huh. It's a speed. Hi, everybody. I am Pat O'Brien, and here I am, Echo and All, and we're here in our Clean Radio studios across Los Angeles, across the country, and really across the world. And we're everywhere, and we're going to New York soon, Miami, Chicago. We're all over the place, and let me do the traffic here first. We have a great show for you tonight. First of all, we're on 790 KBC. You know that. We're also on iHeart Radio. We're KVI in Seattle and KXL in Portland, Astoria, KST in Eugene. And, you know, this thing is growing and growing and growing and about to be a television show. We have a call-in number, which you can use. The lines are lighting up already, so I'd get in. 800-2... It's like calling a New York taxi.
Which nobody does.
Right. 800-222. You like that joke. Who laughed? Yeah. Nobody's ever laughed at that. 800-222-5222. 800-5222. 800-222-5222, facebook.com/cleanradio, and we have a...
By the way, Pat, I have to mention that it actually is a New York City taxi cab number. We just forwarded it to us during the show.
Right.
So, yeah, because nobody uses it.
And soon we'll have an app, so we'll be like Uber.
Yeah, we'll be like, great. It's
and we may sound all happy and stuff here, but if you got a problem, we have hotline numbers 24/7, 888-601-6040. Well... this is quite a week. Andrew is back. Hi, Andrew.
Hey, how's it going?
The great Andrew Spanswick, who is becoming my mentor in things of everything. Now, I don't know if that's a sentence, but that's...
I think me showing you taxidermy of boar's heads doesn't necessarily qualify me as a mentor, but we'll go with that.
And he's 8 days married?
Is it 8 days today?
Yes, Lydia, the wonderful Lydia. By the way, how lucky is she? And how lucky are you, by the way?
I'm the lucky one.
Yeah.
She's
And a beautiful wedding. It was at Frank Sinatra's home.
It was beautiful.
It was beautiful, and it was fun to actually see you guys. You're so in love, and to meet all your family. I sat with my new best friend, Helen, who's Andrew's mom. And, wait, does she like me?
She said that she was considering getting over grieving my father and asking you out.
Then so, she likes me.
I guess so.
We'll talk to Dr. Pat Allen about that later. But it was a beautiful wedding, and Andrew and I sat there and watched this magician for about 10 minutes. And
oh, he was just incredibly good but bad, or bad but good.
He was like so bad he was good.
Right, exactly.
I don't think I've laughed that hard.
I mean, it was the most hilarious thing I've ever seen.
But it was beautiful and it was fun. And thank you very much, Andrew, for including me in the family. And everybody was there from the Clean Centers and from Clean Radio and the big people and the little people. It was kind of fun to have the family together.
Yeah, it was great. It was an eclectic group of people, and it really was interesting to see everybody interact.
There's got to be a better word for eclectic, but it's Valentine's.
Diverse.
Yeah. Anyway, welcome back. We've missed you.
Thank you. I love you. I appreciate it.
We're here to help people, and that's what we do. And I've had people come up on the street already in many venues and say, you know, I started listening to your show, and you guys actually do it. A lot of people promise it, but we do it, and we have hotlines that you can call. As I said, the number is 888-601-6040. Yesterday was Valentine's Day, a special day because it was my birthday. Oh. And any woman who goes out with me on Valentine's Day is kind of screwed because it's all about me.
How is that different from any other day?
Exactly.
Exactly.
You've got me down. Jennifer Jimenez is here.
Hi.
And hi, Jennifer. You look beautiful tonight.
Thank you. It's so nice to be here.
The yoga is doing wonders.
It's 5 days of yoga and counting.
an addiction specialist and counselor, and she's also on the Housewives of Beverly Hills. How does it end?
There's a to be continued. No, I don't know.
No, tell us how it ends.
I can't.
Okay.
It ends with drama. How's that?
What a surprise.
Right. Yeah, I know. Shocking.
Is it any good this year?
It's very controversial. It's interesting to say the least. It's good. It's bad. It's hard to watch. It's easy to watch. It's filled with just a lot of drama.
Andrew, people love to watch these shows. Is it because they wish they were part of it, or because they?
I mean, I'm not really sure. I don't watch them, but I think people like sensationalism, mm-hmm. and they, you know, they like to see things that are worse off than people that are worse off and more horrible than they are.
And they just feel like they could relate at times, and then other times they like to watch the glamour of it all.
And it's gossipy, you know, it's gossipy entertainment. Yeah.
I mean, there's some women on that show that are amazing women, and I love very much.
I once asked Steven Spielberg. I said, is this movie worth $200 million? And he said, that's the wrong question. The question, Pat, is this movie worth $9, the price of a ticket?
Right.
50 Shades of Grey is worth about $2, maybe. although, at
it's
11, 12, 14,
movie right now.
$14 a ticket, it's done about $100 million over the weekend, $158 million worldwide. And I'm going to guess right now, probably one of the biggest grossing movies in history.
It broke all records in history of the month of February.
Well, 100 million people read the books.
So not adjusted for inflation, but... Yeah.
So what it has to do with us is that... exactly. It's a movie about, just a quick summary, about a young girl who gets involved with this very wealthy man, supposedly handsome. This guy, well, not only handsome in the movie, he's like a robot, but...
Yeah,
and he's into submission and dominance, and he asks her to sign a contract where he can do anything he wants to her. She's not allowed to touch him. She's not allowed to put her arms around him. They're not allowed to go out. And it's sort of this distant relationship that's based on sex, but only for him.
Mm. Sounds very boring.
Well, the movie was horrible.
Okay. I can't believe you went to go see it.
Well, because I knew we were going to talk about it tonight.
Mm. Oh, I didn't.
But it brings up a good question, Andrew, and that is sex. You know, addiction has so many layers and so many textures. You know, we talk about alcoholism and gambling and eating and
process addictions.
Yeah. Right.
Porn.
Religion.
Porn.
Yeah. Is
religion.
Sex.
Wow, there you go.
And when we get around to, well, first of all, Dr. Pat Allen is here tonight. The love
doctor.
You're
so cute, by the way.
I am?
Cute?
Yes.
At 80, that's a nice thing
you're
to say.
So
oh, I
cute.
Thought you were saying I was cute.
Oh,
it
my
is
God.
All about me. Dr. Pat Allen and I have a lot of friends in common, but she's been around for 42 years helping men and women with their relationships.
And the same name.
And, well, soon to be the same first and last name the way we're going so far.
Right.
she's so cute.
Have you ever married an older woman, Pat?
Not yet.
Well, there's a first time for everything.
That's one benefit of being immature for much of my life.
Oh.
I'm young when I'm old.
Oh, well, that's amazing. There you go.
Dr. Pat Allen and I have many friends in common. We'll not have to get into that, but she's got a book coming out called Getting to I Do, and we'll get to that in a minute. But let's settle into sex addiction here. Andrew, is there such a thing? Because people say, how can you be addicted to sex? Because it's something everybody wants to do.
Well, yeah, there is sex addiction, and it's, you know, there's like everything and every type of addiction is on a continuum. So you can have low levels of sex addiction where sex becomes inappropriate in your life and you start missing out on other key events. But you can also have very extreme types of sex addiction where people masturbate so much their genitals bleed.
Oh,
and
gosh.
So, I mean, you know, your average person doesn't really see the full spectrum of how sex can actually overwhelm
people
somebody.
At it.
Yeah, people, well, because often it's used in the media as an excuse for bad behavior is viewed by society and an excuse to get out of a mess. You know, Tiger Woods, for example, I don't think he's really a sex addict. He may be, I don't know, but
he's not. I know him very well.
To me, he's just, you know, a guy that
horny.
Was a golfer that got, like, you know, cheap looking blonde girls. So,
well, would
anyway,
doctor,
except for his wife who looked very,
she's gorgeous.
Yeah. Dr. Pat,
ex wife,
yes,
sex addiction, your
there
thoughts
are three...
on it.
There are three sources of dopamine addiction. One is sex, one is money, and the other is mind-altering chemicals. In order to be an addict, in my office anyway, you have to have a chemistry. There are pain addicts that are hooked on norepinephrine. They go berserk when they're having a good time. So they sabotage everything. So sex addiction in my world is an addiction to dopamine, just like cocaine.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely the same process of of the of what causes addiction in the brain is hijacked by these different things.
You're absolutely right.
Absolutely, yeah. And you know, I think a lot of it though is though that there is a continuum, and so so some people, you know, start off slow. And I think one of the things that's great about shows like this and what we see now in the treatment industry is that we're catching these things earlier before they become completely destructive to people's lives.
And I've seen I've met sex addicts who are destroyed because of it.
Absolutely.
They can't concentrate, and their brain, of course, all our brains, those of us who are alcoholics and drug addicts or whatever, or in recovery, all our brains, Andrew, are always just saying more, no matter what it is, right?
Yeah, I mean, I had one of my best friends died of AIDS, actually, in 2004, and he was a sex addict, and I had never really experienced, like, being around someone who was a sex addict, but we'd be, like, in a meeting, he was a lawyer, you know, went to Cornell University, and, you know, all of a sudden he would just disappear out of the office. And then he'd come back, like, you know, 45 minutes later with having taken a shower and, like, with some story about somebody you hooked up with. I'm just like, you know, well, I was here working, you know?
Yeah. We sort of half giggle and wink about it, but it's
but
not
But it got to the point where he couldn't get out of the house.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
His whole day was governed by who he was going to hook up with all day long.
Well, I have a question to ask. A lot of people get this a little confused, and I'm sure you guys can clear it up for us, is, you know, they ask me, like, if you have mental disorders and you act out like bipolar too.
Yes, that's a chemical problem.
But you act out sexually, do you have a sex... do you have a sex addiction problem? Or, you know, does that consider part of that?
Bipolar is a chemically based swinging of chemistry. Addictions are doing something that's normal to the point that you're producing so many neurotransmitters and so many receptors that, like, your first shot of cocaine is the best one. And your first illicit sex is the best one, because then you've got more and more and more and more receptors which scream to be fed.
And don't they?
And that's what happens.
And that's the thing with all addictions, isn't it?
Yes,
and all of you.
All
I mean,
of
the once
all
once
of
once your brain says, because the brain, and then we're going to go on the assumption brains are wired differently.
Well, there's a lot of different theories. There's, like, exposure theory, that if you're exposed to something that's a toxin or a behavior that's going to become compulsive for you, and you have a predisposition to being compulsive, then once you're exposed to that, then you're going to process that compulsively. And we see that where people all of a sudden, you know, they're 19, they've never had a problem with drinking, they never drank. All of a sudden they drink and boom, they're off to the races. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's very much about body chemistry and also
very
environment.
Much.
And
very
also
much.
Environment, though. Environment's a big part of it.
Let me give out a number. 800-222-5222. Give us a call. Lines are, there's room now to call. 800-222-5222. Dr. Allen, what was conversational rape about? Did you write that
conversational
book?
Conversational rape is about intimidation and seduction. When you play games and you get anxious, that's when we call out for our addictive release mechanisms. Some people go religiously fanatic. Some people go masochistic. Some people go alcoholic. It's when you can't ask for what you want and say no to what you don't want and negotiate. There's only three ways to deal with people: intimidate them, seduce them, or negotiate with them.
And sometimes sometimes.
What about ignore them?
No. Well, sometimes
ignoring is healthy.
Right.
Yeah.
I
wish
I knew that one.
See, the problem with an addict is somebody who has to solve the problem won't leave the scene.
So I should ignore my wife.
No. Oh, my God. Stop this. Please. Please, stop.
I know. I haven't had a chance anymore.
Andrew, stop.
Yeah, okay. All right. I'm sorry.
But
I'm really trying to get this marriage to work here. So
it's
going to
work.
I need some advice.
So. It better work.
Right.
What about people that have been abused or, you know, raped and all that? Like, and then they start acting out sexually. Is there?
They do.
They do, most of them, right?
Do you know that a girl that's molested before her first period automatically develops she develops those receptors that scream for more and more sex.
Why?
Why?
No, that's bad.
Why?
Why?
That's right.
It's nature's way of saving her, because nature believes she's been thrown away by her tribe, and when she gets picked up, she's going to be the sex object for the new tribe.
See, I've always thought that it was mastery over the aggressor. You know, where
the aggressor over the dominator. The
mastery over the aggressor, right? So that the woman has been raped by a man, and so to try and regain strength and power, she tries to master men and then will sexually act out and
we're
take advantage of men.
We're talking about molested.
Yeah.
Well, molested girls, if you get them early enough, you mm-hmm. ruin and break their brain so that they will be sex addicts.
Right.
That's Dr. Pat.
To survive. Yeah.
Right. That's Dr. Pat Allen. She's called the Love Doctor. Conversational Rape was one of her books. Her next one is Getting to I Do, which Andrew did 8 days ago. And she also wrote The Truth Will Set You Free. And her motto is Life is a Gift. And her life's goal has always been to give something back. And we love you for that. Yeah, Jennifer Jimenez is with us and kind of a regular here. And since it is Valentine's weekend, we do love her too.
Oh, and I love you guys.
How many people have you, and Andrew Spanswick, of course.
Can I just ask Dr. Pat, what do you think of the concept of obey in marriage and vows?
Obey?
Yeah. Do you think it's Absolutely. Good that they got rid of it, or do you think it should be back in the vows?
No, it's coming back. Didn't you see that UCLA or something? When is no?
No, I didn't.
No, it wasn't in his vows. Wait. That's what he's saying.
Yeah. Well,
the point is that when you've got three dances to do when you mate.
Okay.
Mate is marriage without a document. Marriage is mating with the document.
Okay.
You can either disco, which means you connect to pick up the paycheck or get laid or do whatever.
Right.
Hooking up, I think, is called.
Hooking up, right. Yeah.
Then you have the slam dance, which is codependency. That's the 10 with the 0.
Right.
And then you've got the covenant, that's a legal choice
sure.
in Louisiana, Arizona, Minnesota, and Michigan.
Louisiana.
That choice is where one person signs a contract with the state that they will not divorce and they will pay the bills for the family, and the other person agrees to stay at home and take care of the kids.
By the way, the next half hour, Dedeker Winston's coming in, who is a an advocate of polyamory.
So what about the obey part? Like, why
the
is that important?
The obey part is, when you're in a disco marriage, you don't have to obey your two equal.
Right.
That's called competition and probably a roughly 3-year marriage and then a great divorce. Takes
really?
A long time. Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
And a codependency is seen by some religions and some cultures as being the appropriate way to be. Me man, you woman, me boss, you not.
Right.
You see?
So and obey doesn't work with that one either.
Yes, it does.
Oh, it does? Oh, obey is important for that one.
Countries do it.
Okay, right, yeah.
I don't want to mention any.
Okay, right, yeah.
And religions,
right,
they
we don't,
do it
we don't
too.
Want to get shot or blown up.
You're
so.
Not kidding.
Yeah,
you're
okay,
not kidding.
Right.
And the covenant is the one that looks like it's equal to people that throw in money and do chores, but they have decided that they want the pilot and the co-pilot. Two pilots on a plane, not going to work. Two co-pilots, not going to work.
So how do you negotiate that?
I got news for you. First of all, they find a therapist that believes in variety.
Right.
Because, see, people want a covenant and one wants a codependency.
Well, people want what they want, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's
but
the problem.
They don't. I help them negotiate time, space, money, and play.
Huh.
If they're, you need three things to be in love. You need chemistry.
Mm-hmm. Right.
If you don't have chemistry, the money ain't good enough, and the green card ain't good enough for more than 3 years.
Right.
3 years.
Well, 3 years.
But
infatuation, enjoy, boring.
Right.
If you're in love, chemistry, compatibility. Mm. Our lives fit together.
Right.
Creatively. And the third thing is communication. You got to be able to ask for what you want, say no to what you don't want with respect and cherishing.
Amen to that, because I believe
there
that.
You go.
Hallelujah.
I do believe in that.
Yeah. Do you think that the iPhones and whatever people use and communicate by texting more often than they do by calling each other?
I got news.
Which is
too.
Also, Andrew, an addiction, right?
Yeah.
One that both of us have.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
But and I don't think I'm ever without this thing within 5 feet of me. I'm holding up my phone.
That there are some couples who are one is too emotional for the other. I require that they go in separate rooms with their computers because they can communicate better on.
Really?
Absolutely.
Hmm.
You see, the truth about a good relationship is, number one, you don't need a legal contract. Two, all you got to do is find somebody that's willing to assist you in creating a marriage that is good for you.
Can I get your phone number after the show?
You got it right now.
Okay, babe. Babe? I just call her Babe?
Well, you
I
guys
love
are getting,
this woman.
You guys are getting married, so she's
You're
setting up the
I
whole
her.
Relationship.
Jennifer, you know, among your friends, not to say that they're all, you know, crazy, But when you guys sit around and talk, I mean, do you talk about, I know women talk about sex, believe me, but do you ever, does anybody ever sit at a table and say, I think I might be addicted to sex?
I've had that
with a straight face.
No. I've had those conversations with friends at times. I think they use different words. Also, you know, they act out and they go, oh, yeah, well, I was just lonely. Most of the time they use the fact that they're lonely, you know, and they want to feel loved.
Well, that's normal, right, Andrew? But, you know, we're talking about recovery here.
Yeah.
And by the way,
well,
if
the question is, at what cost does it come, right? If you're basically entering into meaningless relationships and to try and comfort yourself for something that actually doesn't get solved, then you're actually delaying any real help or any real understanding about yourself and any maturity. Wouldn't you agree with that?
If you don't communicate and you don't have compatibility, the chemistry will not carry you.
Yeah. Right.
If you've got chemistry and you've got compatibility, you're negotiating a trick or a love affair.
Here's the problem is that, as we said at the beginning of the show, and if I interrupt a lot, it's because I want to, and I want to try to get us back on.
Well, you're also the host, Pat.
I want to get us back on track a little bit, and I'm the one that's getting us off the track. But recovery, and let's go 1, 2, 3 here. Recovery is such a, as I said earlier, it's like a quilt. I mean, there's so many pieces to it that I think people hear alcoholism, and that's about all. And we always say we're here to end the stigma, but recovery, Andrew, and we deal with this at the Clean Centers, by the way. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I'm starting a group at the one in West Hollywood this week.
I'm excited for that. It's gonna be great.
But, you know, I think we don't, and I know the Clean Center, do you identify that when you come into a recovery center, it's not only what you came in for, because there might be, and I always say is alcohol, and then there's the ism.
Right.
But I know that you do that over clean. It's necessary, right? So you don't have all these other things. Try to control it.
You know, there's several stages to treatment, and detox is obviously the first step after evaluation. And, you know, that's important because you can't really find out what a person's really going on. You can't, what we call baseline them. So we can't find out what their baseline is or their foundation of their personality and what problems they may have until they've already been detoxed.
I have a question already for Dr. Pat Allen, the love doctor, and my new best friend, I might add.
Mm-hmm. Fiance, okay, I heard.
Well,
fiance,
it's not.
With potential.
Potential fiance.
I'm a recovering
Don't
sex
you glare
addict.
At me.
Oh.
Dr. Pat, here's a 23-year-old, and this comes up a lot in recovery meetings. She's only 3 months sober, and I say only, and I shouldn't have said that. The world record's 24 hours, so she's got 3 months, and I apologize for that. Her name is Mary. Her sponsors, and some of those sponsors can be good, some can be awful, says that she needs to wait a year before dating. But then she's talking to people at meetings, and they say they're already dating, and she's afraid that if she doesn't pursue this guy she likes, she'll lose him. So what do? Do you go by the book and say, well, they say don't date for a year, yes, or do you go with your heart?
What you do is, number one, you have a sponsor or a therapist that believes that you don't have intercourse because if you're a young woman, you the risk of bonding to the oxytocin. She's 23. She's a young woman. Oxytocin is the super glue at the short hair sites.
What does that mean?
That means that when you are an addictive personality and you imbibe in intercourse and you're a young woman on estrogen or you're an older man on estrogen, you will bond to that person. And when you bond, you have not got enough program under your belt. So what I say to my people is date all you want, but don't let them in.
I saw a bumper sticker one time. This isn't a Brian Williams story. This actually happened. I saw a bumper sticker that said, "I'm out of estrogen and I have a gun."
Oh.
Andrew, before we go to break, your thoughts on that? I mean, this whole idea of if you're trying to get sober, don't have sex and don't let him in.
No,
as a doctor.
Don't have intercourse.
Intercourse. You can be sexual without having intercourse.
He can go down on you. You can give him a hand job. I don't care what you do. I just don't want in.
Dr. Pat Allen, you're coming back. I'll tell you that. We love you.
Wait, to me, just quickly, it's about boundaries. So, you know, it's about giving yourself enough time to get to know yourself again and figure out where you are. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people that are addicts are developmentally delayed, and they need to catch up to themselves in their appropriate age and appropriate relationship.
Excellent.
I'd say to the 23-year-old to wait, listen to her sponsor or therapist.
Another idea on all this is polyamory, which means having several relationships at once. Dedeker Winston will come by to talk about that. Dr. Allen, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. You so I enjoyed much. Myself.
It was wonderful. I hope so. Thank you. And you and Pat are going out next week.
Well, if he asked me, I'm okay. The girl.
All right.
Me girl.
By the way, you're paying, too.
Oh, my God.
We'll be back right after this.
Are you addicted to drugs or alcohol, but unable to commit to an inpatient rehab stay? Introducing KLEAN Treatment Center's Outpatient Treatment. This drug and alcohol treatment program is designed specifically for the working professional. Don't let your commitments of running a business, taking care of a child, or maintaining your college classes get in the way of your recovery from addiction. With daytime, evening, or individualized programs, KLEAN's Outpatient Treatment will fit your life. Call now for a free screening. Professional guidance is standing by.
Hi, everybody. I'm Pat O'Brien. Hello, YouTube. Thanks for joining the KLEAN Radio channel. Be sure to subscribe and get weekly episodes and clips. And comment, like or dislike, whatever. Be nice. We respond to everything.
Welcome back to KLEAN Radio, your forum on addiction and mental health issues. Join the conversation by calling 800-222-5222, 800-222-5222, online at KLEANradio.com, that's KLEAN with a K, Facebook.com/KLEAN Radio, and on Twitter at KLEAN Radio. Now back to Los Angeles. This is KLEAN Radio.
Welcome back. I'm Pat O'Brien. And one of the reasons I'm here is I've been through all this. Coming up on 7 years. Well, I'm not coming up on it. Next summer I'll be 7 years, God allowing. And I'm here because I've been through it, every bit of it. And Andrew's here because he knows about it. And Andrew Spanswick and runs these great rehabs, which are gorgeous, and they get things done, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, we got a couple new ones opening up, which I'm excited about.
The one up in Lapine.
The one up, just outside of Bend, Oregon.
Ooh, I want to go
it's,
there.
It's really an amazing facility. It was built for an assisted living home by the Catholic Church, and they couldn't make it work, and so I bought it, and it's just absolutely stunning.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Awesome. We'll have to go to your Oregon one, too, the Portland one.
Yeah, Portland, we've got an IOP, an intensive outpatient in Portland that just opened up, and it's doing really well as well.
As for KLEAN centers here, you can call our 24-7, that means all the time, hotline, which is 888-601-6040, 888-601-6040. Our director and CEO, quite honestly, of our social media is Buddy Totten. Buddy,
hi,
how are
buddy.
You?
I'm good. How you doing?
Buddy.
No time for chat. What do you got tonight?
Okay, well, we will get right to it. So this is what's happening on Facebook/KLEAN Radio and Twitter at KLEAN Radio.
Good
so
job.
Sarah says, Pat, I'm a professional musician and songwriter. I've been sober for over a year. Drugs, she feels, is a big part of her creativity, and now she feels that spark is diminishing. And she wants to know, what do you do to stay motivated in your recovery?
Right. Well, first of all, thank you for that question. And go down every big name musician you can think of. Start with Elton John, and go up or down. Start with the biggest bands, the biggest groups, everybody. They've all had the same thought. Will I be able to create? Will I be able to go back on stage? I've talked to them. I've been through it with them. I've discussed it with them. And they're all scared to death because they don't think they can, Andrew, they don't think they can be as creative without getting high. Now, the first thing when I decided finally to get sober over 6 years ago, my first thought was, now I can't go to Italy. I mean, it's the dumbest things that come into your mind, you know?
And right, you can't go to Italy if you can't drink.
And by the way, I wrote a best-selling book on its third printing in sobriety. So, I mean, you just have to, you know, you just have to stay at it, right? I mean,
my experience with artists and speaking with them is that most of them find that when they get sober, that they realize that when they were getting high, they actually couldn't remember what mm-hmm. they were doing creatively. And so once they get sober, they're actually more productive. So, and a lot of people I've met, you know, who've been sober 18 plus years that are great musicians, top national musicians. I'm not going to say their name on the air, but, you know, they really regretted the time they lost by mm-hmm. using instead of being productive in their career.
And you got, I mean,
so there's a lot of hope to go out there and really do what you know how to do.
You become much more creative, I believe. I mean, I know that I had that problem too. Like acting, I was like, am I going to ever be able to tune into that
right.
medium place, I used to call it, and it's so much easier.
One more, buddy.
You got it. Gloria says, Pat, I recently moved to the U.S. from Central America, and I'm newly sober. My whole family drinks, and it is the source of a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. When I bring it up to my family, they say that drinking is a part of our culture and it's not a problem. How do I help my family understand?
Well, let's not throw Hispanics or any part of the world under the bus here, right, Andrew? I mean,
yeah.
Really? So, let's not. Yeah.
Jennifer, is that your whole family?
No, I mean, some people drink more than others, and it can be a white family, a yellow family, a black, you know?
Well, I think the interesting part of this question is we're talking about family systems and
culture.
Family dynamics. So it doesn't really matter what culture you're come from. If you come from a family that's predisposed to heavy drinking and alcoholism, you're going to be exposed to that in your environment. If you happen to realize that that's not what you want out of your life and it's not healthy for you, then it's important to set proper boundaries with your family and get around mm-hmm. a support group that can make you feel comfortable and that you can talk to. And then if there's other things going on that are abusive or whatever, it's about boundaries and protecting yourself.
Right. Yeah. The great Buddy Totten, who's our chairman of the board of our social media, another good job.
All right.
I'm sorry, I cut a little short today, but you're always on top of it, and we thank you for that.
You bet.
Thanks, buddy.
Left the pin in once again. We're on Facebook.com/KLEAN Radio or Twitter @KLEAN Radio. Our next guest is, I can't wait to talk to Dedeker because I know of her work, and lately there's been a lot of talk about up in Silicon Valley. About the people up there that have multiple relationships. And I'm not talking about threesomes, okay? I'm talking about people who are serious about polyamory, which is, well, we're going to have her describe it because I can do it. She is an advocate of polyamorous relationships, and she's here, Dedeker Winston. Hi, Dedeker.
Here I am. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I appreciate it.
What is polyamory?
Oh, my goodness. Well, it's Valentine's weekend, and so, of course, every media outlet has to run the obligatory story on polyamory. Because it is intriguing. It's that perfect mixture of not a lot of people know about it, and maybe it has something to do with sex, so I'm going to click on the title of the article, you know. So polyamory means conducting multiple meaningful romantic relationships between consenting adults with full honesty and disclosure.
So you could be married and have a boyfriend? Or
yes.
Okay.
And in polyamory, kind of what I say all the time to people is that it's so much more about the fluidity of the relationships rather than the form. So it doesn't mean that it has to be a threesome or it has to be a husband and a boyfriend or it has to be two
girlfriends. I'm just glad to hear that I can have a boyfriend.
But does it, for people who haven't heard about this, we just had Dr. Pat Allen on, she talks about negotiation. Is it a constant negotiation to convince someone that you will be sleeping, I'm just going to use you, you'll be sleeping with one person, or let's say you in general, I'm going to be sleeping with one person one night and mm-hmm. somebody else the next night, and you can do nothing about it? Or does everybody have to negotiate that relationship?
And you can do nothing about it. It makes it sound like such an ultimatum.
I think you draw straws.
It makes it sound like I'm forcing this on somebody.
No, but I think that's what a lot of people think. Not that you're forcing it.
Yeah,
but
no, for just, sure. Yeah.
How do you find time? That would, for me, like...
I'm trying to be open about this conversation right now, and it's like driving me crazy.
Right,
I don't know if it's a Latin in me.
No, it's fine. Well, certainly the huge thing is communication, and that's in every relationship, right? Whether it's polyamorous or monogamous or anything in between, communication is key. Like Dr. Allen was saying, knowing how to ask for what you want and what you need, and also knowing how to receive that from your partner as well. And so, yes, it's surprising to some people, but the biggest problem in polyamory doesn't tend to be jealousy. It tends to be just scheduling and time management.
Oh,
yes.
You just
have to get creative with time management.
But like, how can jealousy not be a piece of this?
That's what I was just going to say. Like, what about...
Jealousy is definitely a factor. What you have to keep in mind is that there's so much to jealousy that we're taught by culture. There's this people kind of think that, to be polyamorous, you must not be jealous at all. And that's totally not true. Jealousy is a human emotion, just like any other emotion. It comes up. How you react to jealousy, how you choose to act or not act on jealousy, how you communicate the jealousy is where the big difference lies.
Yeah, I don't react well with jealousy.
If you look at most cultures around the world, they're patriarchal.
Yes.
And most polyamorous relationships in cultures around the world, where one man having many wives.
Yes, yeah. Usually they're polygynous relationships.
Okay.
Yes.
So, we're not talking about Mormons here.
This is most of the world is like that. Most of the world is not actually coupled up. Most of the world is engaged in some sort of, group endeavor. Really?
Yes, definitely. Yeah. And there's this fantastic book called Sex at Dawn by Christopher Ryan. And he delves into an examination of cultures across the world where, you know, long-term monogamy isn't the cultural norm, where it's either polygynous, polyandrous. There's several cultures where women are allowed to take more than one husband, or just straight up polyamorous, where just everybody has multiple partners.
Dedeker Winston is our guest, and multiamory.com, right?
Yes, you
got it. M-U-L-T-I. If you don't know how to spell it, look at your vitamin bottle. Then take the first word off.
That's the first part of it, yes.
So it's Multiamory, yes. M-U-L-T-I-A-M-O-R-Y.com.
Yes.
You know, the Silicon Valley thing has been big in the news. CNN has been running a lot about it. And I think people were, like, I've anchored the news everywhere. And these anchors act like, you know, what? You know, how does that work? Well, how does it work?
How does it work? You might have to clarify, with the sex in Silicon Valley, were they focusing more on swinging or was it actual polyamory?
No, it was actually, they did say polyamory,
so
I'm going to have to trust them.
Well, it
wasn't Brian Williams, by the way.
Okay, good. As long as we're clear on that. It is a huge basis, as I said, of communication and honesty. So I live with my primary partner, Christopher, and for the time management thing, we share a Google Calendar. So I know what date of the week, maybe he's spending the night somewhere else. He knows when I'm going on a date. It's completely, everything's on the table of who we're spending time
with. And do you discuss it afterwards?
Sometimes, yeah. Usually, yes, if we feel like it. But there's none of this like cloak and dagger kind of I'm going to insulate all of my relationships.
That's what Pat wants.
Insulate all of my relationships.
Cloak and dagger.
Shut up. What's wrong with you?
I don't know.
Okay.
I got married. I'm happy.
I mean, I have a question like for, and it's not like, it's not condoning or like, or getting angry at anyone particular. Like for me, I'm a very jealous person. Like I can't share my man. Like I just can't. I wouldn't. If he wants to share, like do that, I'd be like, it's over. Like how do people compromise? How do people, like what if one person's not open to the idea? Like say you and I'm a man, you're a woman, you were dating, and then you say I want to be in this relationship, like, and I say no, is that like a deal breaker?
Honestly, I probably won't engage with you because you're never going to be happy.
Got it.
Right. And honestly, when I was first getting into this community and this lifestyle, for a long time I thought that I could convert everybody.
Yeah.
Well, that surely this is just superior. And so, of course, they're going to want to do it my way. And I broke a lot of hearts that way. Had my heart broken several times that way.
Well, how does someone, there are so many, it seems to me there are so many, I was going to say entry barriers,
that's another discussion.
That's a whole.
But you know what I mean. I just think there's so many predisposed thoughts about this kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I'm, by the way, I love your openness about it.
Mm-hmm, I do too.
But culturally, we're raised to be monogamous because of the general standard religions of
Judeo-Christian
culture,
yes, and
right?
The status quo. Yes.
In the Quran, you're allowed four wives or one wife and a rotating slave wife.
Yes.
So, you know, different cultures have different rules.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm Latin. My father's from my family's from Argentina, and my dad had many women. You know, I mean, and that's how all the generations before were.
Yeah.
But now it's an open conversation and it's an open agreement, which I think is great. I mean, if it's going to go that way.
And part of it is changing our attitudes and the way we look at love. You know, there's this we have this false economy of love with romantic love only, that if you love somebody else, that's love you're taking away from me. Mm-hmm. We don't have that false economy with children, with friends.
So do you have kids?
I don't.
So how would that work into it? Because that seems, you know, my just a little thing here. One of my uncles actually was married to my aunt, who is my father's sister.
Oh, this is a little thing?
Yeah, this is actually a big thing. So
this is the big reveal.
So no. So he had three wives, and he lived in Amsterdam, and he had a house with three floors. Mm-hmm. And I went over there when I was like 13, and they had this big kitchen table at the bottom, and they'd all come down and have breakfast. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my cousin now is just horrified by it.
Really?
Yeah. He grew up in it and he was like, he felt like his mother was stupid and ignorant and didn't really, and got taken advantage of.
Yeah. I think one of the problems with, it's not really a problem, but a problem with everything in recovery and new ideas, is 500,000 people in this country are into polyamory, right?
Last statistic I heard was like it was about 4 or 5% of the population identifies openly anyway.
Yeah. So it's getting the information to people. We don't want everybody to go out and say, okay, honey, I just heard Dedeker Winston on the radio. Let's get a calendar, and I've got a date on Friday night. I mean, that's not what we're talking about, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah. No, certainly. I think it's a dangerous thing to think that polyamory is ever going to overtake monogamy or replace monogamy. It's just what works, right, you know, for whoever's involved in it.
And where can people get more information? Your website, Multiamory.
Yes, my website. I run a blog and a podcast on it.
There's a lot of
Yes, I am in the very scary process of starting to write a book about it. There are several fantastic books on polyamory. The Ethical Slut by Dossie Easton and Janet Hardy, Sex at Dawn, like I mentioned. And if you put in polyamory into Amazon, you'll find probably the top three or four books that are all fantastically written.
It's interesting though that they call it polyamory, but all the books are about sex.
How do you mean?
Well, it's like love and loving someone and having a relationship that's loving isn't necessarily sexual.
Mm-mm.
But all the books about polyamory always mention sex for some reason.
When I had my scandal 10 years ago, I should have thought of this. I'm polyamorous.
Yeah, right? You should have just been like,
F you, right? I'm polyamorous. Yeah,
right? No, I think it's a great way, though, to go. If that's, you know, if you're going to be in an open relationship or in a relationship, we're going to have it. You know, you have like honesty on the table. Mm-hmm.
And something that I want to urge is that it's not just about the sex. You know, that's always what the media wants to hone in on is, well, how does the sex work? And that was kind of our problem with acceptance of homosexuality, is when in the 50s you saw a homosexual person, all you could think of was the sex. They were identified just with the particular kind of sex they had rather than the love and relationships that they had.
And once again, I go back to information, because remember the day when... And it was the All-Star Weekend, All-Star Games on tonight, and I did all those games back in the 80s and 90s, and I remember when Magic came back from announcing he had HIV. People had no idea what HIV was, and players didn't want to play with him, and guys were, you know, can you kiss somebody who's been talking on a payphone?
Mm.
And for those of you out there, a payphone used to be something that you didn't hold in your hand. But I mean, and then look where we are now, Andrew.
Yeah, you put a dime into it as well.
Yeah. A dime.
Yeah. It was a dime when I was young.
But Andrew, it's all about information, and that's what we're about here,
yes,
because people are past, I think most people are past the gay thing now.
Yes.
Lesbian, gay, and transgender. They're even past the transgender right now.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, it's about, you know, shame, stigmatization, and then also, is it healthy? And I think that a lot of people's concerns about polyamory is that there isn't evidence, you know, certainly you look at monogamy and it doesn't necessarily always look healthy, but there isn't really a poster child for polyamory yet.
Yes.
And I'd be really interested to know, like, if you know of any studies about, like, do people age out of this? Is it something that's generally with younger people and then people tend to couple up and become more monogamous as they get older?
Oh, heavens no.
Really?
No, the studies that have been done on it, it's a very eclectic mix of people from across the board, you know, and people raise families this way. There are polyamorous couples that are polyamorous into their 70s, 80s.
My aunt did.
Yeah. I have a question. What happens, and I'm only using you and your boyfriend because you mentioned that.
Sure.
What happens if you and one of you guys go out and you fall in love with the other person?
We do. We do that. We've done that a couple times.
Okay,
actually.
So then what happens? Yeah. Like, say you fall in love with another guy and you're still with him.
Mm-hmm.
How does that?
I'm going to bring back to the false economy of love, because then it's, well, if I fall in love with somebody else, that means I must not love him anymore. And that's not the case.
So the jealousy, does it ever creep in?
You
seen it?
Jealousy is based in a lot of different things. Most of the time, it's based in insecurity.
Mm-hmm.
And if I have a safe space to express that insecurity or to ask for what I need, if I need to ask for reassurance, jealousy doesn't become a problem anymore.
Would you hand him your iPhone if he asked you?
Yes.
You would?
Yes, I would. Yes.
That's better than you have. Because
it's full. There's, like I said, there's nothing that I'm hiding. You know, I'm not secretly going on dates or secretly having sex or secretly falling in love. You know, these are happening in real time and they're being communicated.
I'm just trying to get to the...
Sounds like so much work. I mean...
No, I don't think so. I think we're misunderstanding something here. And I think it's the bottom line in every relationship, and that's trust.
I think
trust is the biggest thing here.
Yes.
And God love you if you can get past that, because that's the killer of all relationships, right?
Yes.
Jealousy and not envy, but jealousy.
Oh, jealousy for sure, and mistrust and miscommunication.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge one. You know, I know when he goes out on a date, there's no part of me that is afraid I'm going to get replaced, because I know that he loves me. I know my other partners love me, and that I'm the best person at being me, that I can't be replaced, you know?
Mm-hmm. Now, how many Well, let's get a call in. We have no. I mean, I'm trying to ask the
this
questions that people would ask.
Yeah, sure.
Here's Lisa up in Oregon wants to talk about sex addiction. And Lisa, how are you tonight?
No, actually, I wanted to talk about the reverse problem where you're paranoid to be even touched in a sexual manner.
I'm sorry. You're afraid to be
touched. Afraid to be touched.
Sex aversive.
Well, I got raped back in the late '90s, and ever since then, you can just forget about it. But I've also been single for a long time, and I've been, been kind of wanting to get a relationship going with somebody. But a normal man is going to want to have sex, and I'm just totally paranoid of it.
Andrew's going to answer. Lisa, thank you. Andrew's going to answer.
That's a tough one, and the trauma of being raped can be quite extensive, and it's been a while since you've been raped, but the feelings are probably just as strong or stronger as your defense mechanism sort of wane away. So my big thing would be that, clearly I think people naturally want to be in relationships. We're social animals, and I think that that's normal, and I think that's important. And I would really encourage you to go get some therapy and try and work through the trauma of that rape so that you're in a good place to actually then be able to meet somebody and feel comfortable. And also meeting the right person that understands that you had that trauma, and it's going to take you time to get back in the fold.
Thank you for your call. This is Clean Radio. You can find us at facebook.com/cleanradio. We're going to get rid of the slash part in this social, in this computer world. Remember, we used to have to go, we don't even say www anymore.
Yeah.
I do.
Or HTTP.
You do? You do HTTP?
Yeah, all that. Remember, how about DOS? Remember that?
Oh, yeah. C command prompt.
Everything still operates off DOS in some degree.
And we're on Twitter, at Clean Radio. Dedeker, what's your Twitter handle?
It's very easy. It's at Dedeker Winston.
D-E-D-E-K-E-R. Yeah. Dedeker Winston. Yep. D-E-D-E-K-E-R.
I have a feeling her inbox just filled up.
Yeah.
And she sent me a tweet earlier saying, what do we wear to this party?
Yeah, right? You never told me what the theme of the costume party was going to be.
So. I almost killed myself the other day, seriously, texting and driving.
Oh,
and,
really?
And
you're one of those.
Aren't we all one of those?
And I swear to God, I'm never going to do it again. I was going to a recovery meeting early. It was dark. And I was texting somebody like an idiot, a fool, and I looked up and I was heading right towards a pole.
Oh. Wow.
It scared the living daylights out of me. I don't know why I brought it up. So
don't do that at home, kids.
No.
Don't do it in the car.
Or in the car.
You can do it at home. You can't do it in the car.
By the way, if you have any questions, we've had such a remarkable show tonight. It's been tough. We're not done yet. But our Clean Center number is 888-601-6040. 888-601-6040. The Clean Centers are all up and down the West Coast, Northwest, and we're growing across the country. I'm starting a group at one in West Hollywood, one that's close to home, too. But and Andrew, when people call this number, what do they get?
Yeah, it said we have people that are there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
Qualified.
Trained counselors that basically are able to handle and figure out what kind of problem you might have. And if we can't help them, we find a place that can help them. And so, if they have financial issues or problems with insurance, or they need help with insurance, we
navigate all that.
Yeah, and we also help people sort out, what the problem is. And often, sometimes it's just like setting up an assessment to, get better clarity. And sometimes it's people actually that immediately need to come into detox.
And you also have a cleancenter.com, but just go to Clean Radio if that's only, and it's Clean with a K, by the way. Dedeker Winston is here. Where does this movement, the polyamory, go now? Is it because I want to make sure that people know what they might be getting themselves into. Mm-hmm. That we're not talking about just having multiple partners. Mm-hmm. We're talking about having multiple meaningful partners.
Yes. Right. Yes.
That's actually a question. So what,
where is it headed?
Is it something that, I don't want people to just go out and say, hey, I heard this woman on the radio say that I can go have another date.
Yes,
it doesn't have to be part of your fabric and get over all the old monogamous ideas.
No, certainly. And part of my reason why I am an advocate for polyamory is not necessarily to make a bunch of converts or to proselytize or to be a missionary. It's education.
So you're not hitting on Pat.
Well, that's a different question altogether.
Okay, all right.
We'll get to that one later.
Okay.
A broken heart is an open heart.
Wait, she's sitting on Jennifer. That's, now I'm figuring it out.
But let her finish.
Hot.
Okay.
No, but just some awareness and education so that it doesn't have to be misunderstood. And this can be seen as a valid and very healthy lifestyle. I think that a lot of people in our culture choose monogamy because it's a default. Because it's just the default.
It's
what
there.
Our culture says.
Yeah.
It's what our parents say we should do. It's what our church says we should do. And it's not the only option available to us.
And we're not trained to deal with polyamory.
No, not yet. We're not handed that cultural script.
Yeah.
But it can be scary, especially going into a totally new style of relationship where we don't have the cultural script, right. But you get to write your own script.
Hold on a second, you just said something, sorry,
Andrew. Yeah. Is that life is so short, and I've had 5 good friends die in the last 8 days.
Mm.
5
oh,
good
goodness.
Friends.
Wow.
You know, Bob Simon, the great David Carr, who struggled with all this addiction stuff for years. He just collapsed about other people. So life is short. So people deserve to be happy.
Yes.
And, you know, my thing is that you should find what makes you happy, but make sure you know what you're getting into.
Of course.
And what makes you happy.
Of course. Definitely find what makes you happy, but make sure that it's making the people around you happy as well. You know, it doesn't make sense, if you're lovingly married and I'm going to go on a date, but your wife is really unhappy with that, that's not going to work, right?
That's not what we're talking about either.
Yeah, you know, not at all. It involves finding people who are on the same level and who want the same things that you do. You know?
Is there, this is a real question, is there a chat blog or something about this so that
she
if
blogs.
People are interested?
Well, it's her blog.
Yes, I blog. There's several poly blogs out there. Like I said, several books, several Facebook groups, meetup groups. If you do the research, you can definitely find it out there.
Polyamory.
Polyamory. Yes.
Yeah.
Not polyarmory. Not Game of Thrones.
Well, by the way,
I would need polyamory because they'd just be coming after me and with sticks and stones.
You like
to beat them off with your sword?
No.
But it's from a Greek language, which most everything is.
Well, that's actually kind of
means many and several.
It's
right?
A joke that's going around the internet is that poly is actually Greek and amory is Latin,
right.
Which is technically a grammatical or a linguistic. Faux pas to mix roots. It should be either polyphilia or multiamory, which is the name of my site. But polyamory now is the functioning title.
And we don't.
That's called American.
What?
That's
called American. We do what we want with our language.
Yes. And we don't want people just to jump into something without knowing about it. So
Certainly.
The website is multiamory.com.
Yes.
Dedeker, you have been great talking
Excellent.
To you. It's so
interesting.
Thank you for having
so
much.
Me.
Thank you.
And,
I appreciate it.
You were wonderful. And it's not a cult, by the way.
No.
It's not for,
there's no uniforms.
It's not for sissies. I mean, it's called dedication, that sort of thing. Jennifer Jimenez, always great to have you.
So great to be
back here.
And, great to see you and be with you guys.
And Andrew, congratulations on your wedding again.
Thank you so much.
And by the way, for all the work that Andrew does with recovery and also keeping this group together. And I love you for that. We'll see you next week.
I really appreciate it, Pat. Thank you.
I'm Pat O'Brien. Thanks
love
for listening tonight. Remember,
love.
Take care of yourself. And remember, tomorrow's another day.
Are you addicted to drugs or alcohol, but unable to commit to an inpatient rehab stay? Introducing KLEAN Treatment Center's Outpatient Treatment. This drug and alcohol treatment program is designed specifically for the working professional. Don't let your commitments of running a business, taking care of a child, or maintaining your college classes get in the way of your recovery from addiction. With daytime, evening, or individualized programs, KLEAN's Outpatient Treatment will fit your life. Call now for a free screening. Professional guidance is standing by.